favorite cocktail bar. Sipping dry martinis, munching caviar. There's a girl who's really putting them to shame. Rosie is her name. All the day long, whether rain or shine, she's a part of the assembly line. She's making history, working for victory. Rosie, the riveter, keeps a sharp look out for sabotage. Sitting up there on the fuselage, that little frail can do more than a male can do. Rosie, the riveter, Rosie's got a boyfriend, Charlie. Marine. Rosie is protecting Charlie, working overtime on the riveting machine. When they gave her a production E, she was as proud as a girl could be. There's something true about red, white, and blue about Rosie, Rosie.
First job I ever had was in a novelty factory. They made party goods, party hats, noisemakers, these things that kids blow that has feather at the end, rolls up, I forgot what they call them. I was still in high school. Times were very bad. And I was very struck by the bright colors and tinsely things that we were working with and the sadness on the faces of the people who were doing it. It was so boring. It was so, just, you know, one sort of, one movement all the time. Say staple, put it down, staple, do it staple, do it staple. 144 and you've made a dime.
We lived in, oh my goodness, I guess you would call it slums. We couldn't afford electricity because of the Depression. We used oil lamps, kerosene oil lamps, and our variety of diet consisted of a different bean every day. One day you would have white beans, the next day pinto beans, the next day black-eyed peas. I did work at what we call private family, like for a dollar a day. We were called kitchen mechanics and we got Thursday off, and every other Sunday, maybe, if we were very good.
When I met my husband, when I was dating him, well, I was only 14 when I met him. And I thought it was dating, but I guess it really wasn't. But I was riding around in his car, and that was, it seemed like dating to me. And he had a job at Oldsmobile, and I thought he was rich because there was no black men in Oldsmobile. And he said if I would marry him, you know, I could drive the car. We never had a car, and this was really something. I would have married him on that alone. My mother's friends, they were all doing housework or working in restaurants. And, well, that was just about all that was open to them. Now, my mother was fortunate. She got a job in a hotel. It was Old's Hotel at that time. It's Jack Tar now, I think. But there, too, she was just making the beds. She was a chambermaid, that's what they called it at that time. And I just didn't want any of those jobs.
We raised corn, cane, and we'd top the cane and strip it and run it through a molasses mill. We made molasses and we raised everything we ate came off of that farm. But my husband died, my mother-in-law, the farm belonged to her and she sold it. I hitched up my team and my wagon, made a covered wagon and drove from 90 miles northeast of St. Louis to Springfield. My mother lived at Springfield. I thought, oh Lord, what'll I do now? Saw that woman spading that big garden. And I went over there and I said, I have a team and a plow, plowed for you. Time I got hers plowed, here come a man up to me and he said, looks like you're doing a pretty good job there. And I said, well, and he said, I have 6 acres of new ground out here I'd like to have plowed. And, well, know if I could do it, you know, and I said, Sure can. I'll be out there daylight in the morning. So I got out there at daylight in the morning before he did. I'd plowed one furrow, and he was waiting up there at the end till I got there. And he said, looks like you're doing a pretty good job there. I said, thank you. He looked at me and he said, are you a woman? And I said, yes, I am. Why? And he said, well, if I'd known you as a woman, I wouldn't have hired you. I thought you was a big country boy. He said, this is hard plowing. This is new ground. I says, I know it. And you just said I was doing a good job of it. And he said, well, if you think you can do it, go right ahead. And I plowed that 6 acres of new ground. I got a good piece of money for that.
I was working in a job doing housework, but it was a sort of a different kind of housework. You're treated more like one of the family, and I really liked it there. And they had 2 children. But one day, she called me and told me to come listen to the radio.
We interrupt this program to bring you a special news bulletin. The Japanese have attacked Pearl Harbor, Hawaii, by air, President Roosevelt has just announced.
December 7th, 1941, a date which will live in infamy. The United States of America was suddenly and deliberately attacked by naval and air forces of the Empire of Japan. With confidence in our armed forces, with the unbounding determination of our people, we will gain the inevitable triumph. So help us God.
The march of time. The battlefields of America are the production lines. The sweat and muscle and brains of men pounding out the tools of victory, slugging out more and more and more. A mighty industrial program moving faster and faster. Labor supply to match it lagging behind. Men designating themselves an emergency committee. Representatives of government. Leading industrialists. They were determined no woman should cash a check, board a bus, see a movie, or walk down the street without getting acquainted with the idea that she was needed. A woman's committee walked the streets and knocked on the doors. 3 women on your block say they'd get a war job if their neighbor did. How about you?
Somebody had written me the letter from out here in California and said I could make more working out here in a day than I could in a week back there. So
what'd you do?
Well, I told the woman about it that's sitting at the machine next to me, and she said, if you want to go to California with me, you can be ready at 6 o'clock this evening. I really got to move on.
When factory work opened up, it was like a godsend, because there you was earning pretty good money. And my Social Security number, I remember it from heart, almost from the first day, 366249339. I thought that was so terrific that I had a Social Security card and I carried it around in my purse. They sent me right out as soon as I got my Social Security card to a factory.
We were going to get in on the ground floor and be welders forever and ever. And the work on gliders, too, was really very much what I wanted, because it was almost an art as well as a skill. It was a very, very beautiful kind of work.
It takes human power to keep war factories going, and much of our manpower is going to war. More and more men are being called into the armed forces. Their jobs must be filled, and filled now. And who can fill them? You. You women. You're the ones who must fill them, who can give our boys what they need. If you need training, you can get it, and it's free. We must win this war. But we can't win this war unless you women take over the jobs that men are leaving. And you're needed right now.
He said, come on, we can go and get in the shipyards. And so when I tried to get into the shipyards, they told me I had to go to school. And then I found out about Samuel Gompers. And I went to Samuel Gompers and took training for a ship fitter.
Men had been telling us all along the line that, oh, it takes 6 years to become a welder. You've got to be an apprentice. You've got to be this. They had been sold a bill of goods in their lives. You see, it wasn't true at all. It just worked out for bosses to do that. Actually, it could be learned and learned well if it was taught well in a short period of time.
He told me I'd passed 98%. He said, you've got good grades, you passed 98%. Do you know anything that a person's really interested in, why they make better grades out of it than something they don't like to do?
In the sprawling aircraft factories on the West Coast, teams of women flush the rivets that hold together the aluminum skin on the wing of a B-24. This is like punching holes in a tin of scouring powder. Instead of cutting out dresses, this woman stamps out the patterns of airplane parts. They are taking to welding as though the welding rod were a needle and the metal a length of cloth to be sewn. After a short apprenticeship, a woman can operate this press as easily as a juice extractor in her own kitchen. And a lathe will hold no more terrors for her than an electric washing machine.
And it wasn't any time before we got the knack of it. Because for one thing, women's hands weren't as big and clumsy as men. We had to grind our own tools. So therefore, it was easier for us to know when to stop grinding, how to take the machine loose. We had more of a subtle touch with it. Really, I mean, we did better than the men.
They didn't do anything to make it easy for you, unless maybe you'd run into one that was stuck on you and wanted to date you or something like that. And then he'd go out of his way for a little while. If it didn't work out, well, you can get no help from him either.
The men, you know, had the... Sometimes they treated us pretty badly because to a man, when a woman walked in, it meant that a man went to war. And even though the population was very much in favor of the war, on an individual basis, who the hell wants to go to war?
As our armed forces grew, so did their demands for equipment, supplies, food, material of all kinds. The need for women grew desperate, and thousands of women answered the call. The Hidden Army drew fresh recruits. Its ranks grew to nearly 18 million. Many of these women came from walks of life not previously considered. The mothers, the young, the aged. When they were asked why they had joined the ranks of the Hidden Army, these women gave a variety of reasons.
My husband's a prisoner of the Japs in the Philippines. If he'd had a few more of these shells out in Bataan, maybe he'd still be fighting.
I'm an old maid, and I didn't have anyone until I took this defense job. Now, I have a family of 10 million to look after.
Why did I take a defense job? That's a funny question. I never thought of that before. Do you have to have a reason? We're in a jam, aren't we? I'm sorry, but you'll have to excuse me. I'm too busy to answer damn fool questions like that.
Somehow that answer pleased us. No sudden emotional urge sent this young woman into war work. No loss of a loved one. No temporary economic embarrassment. No mere yearning for excitement or novelty. There are millions like her. There will have to be.
I knew I was a riveter, because with all this training, and I really said, this is really going to be nice. But when they sent me in there, they sent me to the foundry. Three-fourths of the women that they sent in there were black, so they sent just enough white women to say that we do have white women here. I expected to see something like I saw in that training center. I expected to see everything all set up to go to start riveting. I said, well, this training is just wasted then. But it just didn't seem to be anything at that time that we could do about it. And for once, I was even afraid to say too much to a committeeman. I was looking them up and finding out who was committeeman and everything, but I said, well, I guess I better kind of, well, you talk to other women about it, and they said, well, we better keep still for a while. At least we're in here.
We went to Moore Shipyard to be signed in because they'd called and said they needed four fitters. And when we got there, the superintendent took the three white persons that was with me and left me sitting outside and came back about 45 minutes and said, no, we don't have any openings. I said, what do you mean? I was told at the school you had five openings, and I was sent here as the person in charge of all the other people. Where are they? Oh, he said, we found places for them. It was clear they didn't want a black woman in the elite trade of ship fitting. God, I was so mad. I got out and I said, is there anything else open? And they said, yes, they had welders and burner jobs open. And the superintendent says, well, you have to go back to school to learn to burn. And I said, no, I don't. You just give me a test and see if I can burn. I got to the instructor who had all this equipment. He says, well, here's a nice thick piece of steel. Bevel it. And I said, okay. So knowing that I would tell the burner to make sure it was good and hot before he started cutting his oxide, I started getting it hot. He said, never mind, never mind. I see you know your business. And then he gave me a piece to cut out with a lot of designs on it. And I got myself down like I'd seen the burners do and started getting ready to start cutting. And he said, never mind. He says, you'll do. I'll send you in as a first stage burner. And I said, okay. And he says, you'll be making $1.05 an hour. If I had gone in as a ship fitter's helper, I would only been making 85. So I was delighted. Here I was making more money in 5 minutes than all the rest of them were making when they went in as helpers. So that's how I got into the shipyard. And I became the only woman ever to make shell burner at Moore Shipyard.
Everyone stops to admire the scene. Rosie at work on the B-19.
She's never twittery, nervous or jittery.
Rosie, Rosie, the riveter. What if she smears full of oil and grease? Doing her bit for the old Lend-Lease. She keeps the gang around. They love to hang around. Rosie, Rosie, the riveter.
Rosie buys a lot of war bonds. That girl really has sense.
And wishes she could purchase war bonds. Putting all her cash in the national defense.
I have worked on the double bottoms clear up to the crow's nest. There's only about 3 feet you have to set down in there to work in the double bottoms. And you can't work in there very long because it gets pretty well filled up with smoke. And then you have to get out.
Welded on the deck, the big slabs of iron that lay on the deck. Welded those together. Welding on the deck is really fun.
I enjoyed every bit of it.
Oh, it was good to work with people. It's something about that camaraderie that you really need on a job. If the job is hard and everybody's working hard, you don't mind. It's just that sharing and all doing it together.
Lunch hour would find us spread out on the sidewalk, women welders with our little outfits, and usually a quart of milk in one hand and a salami sandwich in the other. Workers from other shops on the streets would look at us and say we're welders, and we were interlopers, and we had a happy attitude toward our work that they, of course, really did not have, because they were in the middle and at the end of their stories, and we felt we were at the beginning.
Here is the office of the supervisor of women employees.
Are they doing all right?
Beyond anything anyone ever dreamed of. They're doing something in almost every department in the plant. And I don't mean just clerks and checkers. We have women engineers and oilers in the boiler room. Women repair experts. Women work at the ore mines above ground, along the unloading docks, and our private railroad tracks. And women shipbuilders. These women are working around the clock, around the calendar. They do a man's job, and they can draw a man's pay. And they're doing it safely. They're safer here than in their own homes.
Well, I was welding, and the people up above me, they were knocking some pieces of iron down. I hollered and said, cut that out. First thing I knew, a big piece came down, hit me on the back of the head, and down I went. I was just hanging over the big iron pipes when somebody come in there and got me off of the big iron pipes. I was taken out in the basket. And I barely remembered. I thought, I knew I was in the basket. They have what they call it, the basket, and it's taken out with a crane. You're way up in the air, all right. There was one man that got killed right with about 12 feet of me when I was welding on the deck. A big iron, what did they call those, standards or something like that. Anyway, a big column of iron fell over and just mashed him flat instantly.
This was a job, it was an ammunition place where you had to sift gunpowder and stuff. You had to have shoes that gave you a large insurance. You got a great big insurance, something like $10,000 or something. You had to go and get outfitted for it. For instance, the shoes had to be grounded, and they wouldn't give us the shoes on credit. So they let us work without the shoes. If I had been older, I wouldn't have taken the job because I would have known it was dangerous. Because one of the girls, you couldn't wear a silk stockings. Women wore silk stockings in those days instead of nylons until, you know, they all got away from us, you know, during the war. Then we didn't have any. But she went in with a hairpin in her hair one day, and it created a spark, and she and her partner blew up the smithereens. That's when I said, well, forget this job. I'm not going to work here anymore, so I quit that. It was too dangerous.
Hopsky, this shop on 6th Avenue, wasn't what I was dreaming of. I had wanted to work in some big aircraft plant, like we were beginning to see in the movies. And Kopsky's shop, well, it was an old dive on 6th Avenue, 21st Street. We were very good producers, but we were earning far less than the men who were doing the same work. We certainly wanted to help the war effort. All of us were very involved in those feelings. No one of us came from a family that would take care of us. We had to earn a living, and we were not doing so. One of the women, Blanche, and I went down to a United Electrical Workers Union. We started to wear union buttons, and Mr. Kopsky's face changed. He didn't like us anymore. We were no longer his girls. He didn't like us. And he had a foreman, Emil, who felt personally insulted by our union buttons, because he says that he was good to us, and he was good to us. It had nothing to do with it. It took a few weeks. We got union cards signed. We came to work one morning. Door was locked. We couldn't come in. We were locked out. Interesting sidelight, we had some black women workers with us. They had never before told us, but only when we were organizing in the union did we find out that they were paid 5 cents less per hour than the white workers had been paid. Talk about cheap. So Thelma, our union organizer, came along. She called newspapers, and they came with cameras. The union filed a complaint at the National Labor Relations Board saying that we wanted to work, we were working for the war effort, and he wouldn't permit us to work. His attitude had changed since the union, and of course he said we were no good, we were unskilled, we didn't know what we were doing, we were only good, as he said, for being married and having babies. That's all we were good for. Well, we went to the Labor Relations Board, and they ruled in our favor, and we were members of the Electrical Workers Union, and the change in our money was fantastic. I can't recall now, but it was about an 80% raise.
Oh, it made a great change. I think it made changes in everybody's lives, because we weren't used to making the money that we were making then. You'd think you'd make more in a day than you used to make all week. Oh, you just bought everything. It just never dawned on you to save money. It didn't me. A lot of them did. Some of them said they saved their money just like everything. And somebody would tell me, you know, you better save that money because after the war you can buy a house, you can buy this, you can buy that. I said, I wish they'd quit telling me how to spend my money. I was buying fox furs and all these things. I was just buying anything I could see.
Have you heard that a mini's in the money? Take my word that a mini's in the money. She hasn't got a guy who's got a diamond mine, but she's a welder on the old assembly line. So bless her, sir, a mini's in the money. A mini's in the money, that's fine. She's helping Uncle Sam to keep his people free. She's okay, hooray, a mini's in the do-re-mi.
When I worked at Lockheed or any of the factories, I worked an 8-hour shift. If they asked me to work overtime, I got paid for overtime. So it was a big difference there. It would get boring at times, but all in all, I was doing the same work that other people was doing. And then if things didn't work right, I could always go to the union. Who could I go to doing domestic work? There was no union there to go to. I either had to just quit, pack up and leave, or whatever. But I did have some say-so at a job in the factory. And there was another difference too. Instead of working alone all the time like you do in domestic work, because you're in the kitchen or wherever you're at by yourself, I was always with a bunch of other women.
Many of our girls have never worked before outside their own homes. We have the wives of college professors, club women, homegirls who were doing it as their patriotic duty. One had her own beauty parlor. The other was formerly a cigarette girl in a nightclub. And Rosita Moser, who clerked in one of the country's finest department stores. Now she's in our reclaiming department.
Isn't this a funny place for you?
Not if it helps win the war.
But after clerking in a fashionable store...
I like it here, and it saves my clothes.
Yes, I suppose it would.
Did you ever try pleasing a bunch of women shoppers all day?
No, I never did.
Well, here I just have to please the boss, and he's a man.
Of course, we've made the plants attractive for them. The women have their own lockers and wash-up rooms. They come out from work looking like business girls on vacation, really.
We were surprised to know there was a shower in there, so one of the black women went up. So when she went up there to take a shower, she says, well, I'm going up there. And we said, okay, we'll be up a little later. So when next thing we know was a whole lot of confusion. It got up there and the matron was up there and telling her to come out of there and get out of there fast. And she says, why? She says, you're not supposed to be in there. And she says, those other women are in there taking a shower. She says, well, I don't care who's in there. You're not supposed to be in there. And she said, if you don't come out, we'll get the guard. So we tried to talk her out. We didn't want to see her lose her job. And she said, no, I'm not coming out. She says, as long as they got showers in here and those women are using them, I'm using them too. So they closed the showers down. And so then a lot of them decided not to work with us, period. So the union steward sent to Local 600, and they sent a representative. He asked them what was the matter. Well, they didn't want to talk to him because he was black and they was waiting for somebody else to come. He says, I'm all that's going to be here. So all I want to know is what's wrong. And he said, we're not going to work with those women. He said, what women? And they said, they didn't say black then. They said, well, those colored women. And he says, why did you want to work with those colored women? And they said, we just don't want to. He said, well, do you want the jobs? They said, yeah, we want the jobs. He says, okay, then you go to work. If you don't want the jobs, just turn in your time. That's all you can do. We'll get somebody that does want to work with them. So after that, well, they went on back to work, and they eventually got over it. So we started working after that. Of course, after we worked a while and got used to each other, then we'd laugh about those things.
The day after payday is not the time to relax. Stay on the job and give the axis the axe. Time won't wait for you and me. Don't be an absentee. races when you know that your place is on the old assembly line. No time to go fishing when we need ammunition, and the job is yours and mine. Keep punching the clock until you knock out the foe. Don't stay away or you'll be missing the show. If you want your country free, don't be an absentee.
I needed to do, to take care of my laundry. I needed to do help with the housework when I got home. I was living with my husband's mother at the time and various other relatives who were all sort of together for the war. And things had to be done, and there was never any understanding or any respect really given to women for their life outside of the workplace. And I admit I myself never even gave much thought to women workers who had children. How were they managing?
When I came to San Francisco to work and went to work in the shipyards, I had a little child that I had to leave behind. I had to leave her with my mother because up here I didn't think I would have any place for her to stay. And I was going into a new community in a new town, and I didn't want to bring my child with me. And I left her with my mother, and that was one of the most awful things I think I ever did to anybody, because even today, that child hurts because she felt, because I promised her that, give me 1 year away and I'll come back and get you. And that 1 year stretched into 2 years and finally into 3 years and ended up almost 5 years before I could go back and get her. And that's one of the things that's very bad. If there had been any kind of conditions under which I could have brought her with me, I certainly would have brought her.
But the community knew about that, was planning to meet that. 11-day nurseries, more to follow. Here, women can leave their children while they work, confident of the best of care in the most pleasant of surroundings.
I don't know. I never heard of any, you know, where I could take my children anyway. They're mostly were private ones, and they were way out. I'm sure they must have had them. I had to put my daughter in boarding school. The other one was with her dad. I'd always had her with me, and to have to send her away, but I, you know, ran into so many brick walls, you know, keeping her in private homes and everything. If it wasn't one thing that was happening, and it was something else.
My kid was little, and so I worked at night, and so I would get home in the morning. I didn't have a washing machine, so I washed by hand, hung the clothes on the line. Then I would have to clean the house, bathe the baby. Then I would have to go shopping.
There were lots of dishes every night, pots. My mother-in-law was not young. I would certainly not see her do the dishes. Now my brother-in-law, who was also, he worked at the Brooklyn Navy Yard. And I guess I just accepted it. After dinner, he would lie down on the couch and listen to jazz records. And I felt the need to pitch in the kitchen.
When your husband came home, you know, he propped his feet up and got a can of beer while you fixed dinner. Or even if we weren't working the same shifts, you fixed dinner and left it where it would be convenient for him to get, that sort of thing. So it was very hard for women to really participate in the union meetings.
It just got too much, and I tried so hard to make them see that 10 hours was just too much for me. I didn't mind doing 8 and an occasional 9, but 10 was just too much. I just couldn't do it. And I wrote grievance after grievance, which you just never get anywhere with it.
Some were too tired in the morning to face the assembly line or the workbench. Some found that defense work interfered with their shopping. A few members of the Hidden Army, it seemed, had earned enough for the fur coat they coveted and returned to their pre-war existence. Perhaps the war news looked swell and the compulsion to work was dissipated in the confident talk of victory just around the corner. The papers reported a slight falling off in production. The kids needed looking after and the house somehow refused to run itself when 8 hours a day were spent at the plant. But by far the most common reason was that women were not accustomed to the long hours of hard work. Shortages appeared. American planes found themselves lacking bearing assemblies. Of a sudden, the war was right in the American home. The government regrets to inform.
No, it's a bubble.
Our women learned in bitter tears and heartache, that in war there can be no such thing as a slight falling off in production. Because there's no such thing as a slight death.
You know, if you even talked about the union too much, you were kind of unpatriotic. How dare you talk about not working overtime or not doing more than you were supposed to when our boys were over there dying for us, you know, not for business, but for us. They were dying.
Arm for the love of America.
We've got to get in the race and work at a lively pace.
They say over here is nothing to fear, but let's get ready just in case. Arm for the love of America.
And for the love of every mother's son.
Oh, the fight for freedom can be lost or won by the man behind the man behind the gun, by the man behind the man behind the gun.
I was working down in the hold of the ship. There was about six Filipino men, and over these men was a 19-year-old officer of the ship. And this big white guy went over and started to kick this poor Filipino. And none of the white men that was working down there in the hole with me had said one word to this guy. And I had sat there and I was getting madder and madder and madder by the minute. I sprang to my feet and I turned on my torch and I had a flame about 6 or 7 feet out in front of me, and I walked up to him and I said, "You want me to say the real language?" I said to him, "You so-and-so, if you go lift one more foot, I'll cut your guts out." That was my exact words. I was so mad with him. And then he starts to tell me that he had been trained in boot camp, that any national group who was dark-skinned was beneath all white people. When he started to cry, I began to feel sorry for him because he was crying. He was really crying. He was so frightened. And I was frightened. I didn't know what I was doing, you know. But in the end, I turned my torch off. And I sat down on the steps with him. About that time, the intercom on board the ship started to announce, "Lynn Childs, report to Colonel Hickman immediately." So I said, "I guess this is it." So I went up to Colonel Hickman's office, and behind me came all of these men. They were all lined up behind. And I said, "Where are you guys going?" They said, "We're going with you." He says, "I just wanted to see Lynn Childs." And they said, "Well, you see all of us, because we're all down there, and we all didn't have guts enough to do what she did, and we're with her." So he said, "Come into this office." And he came out and had one of the guards take me inside the office, and he closed the door real fast to keep them out. And he says, "What kind of communist activity are you carrying on down in the hole?" And I said, "Communist, what is that?" He says, "You know what I'm talking about. You're a communist." I said, "Well, if communists object to the kind of treatment that man was putting on those Filipinos and would come to their rescue," I said, "then I am the biggest communist you ever saw in your life." I said, "That is great. I'm a commie." He said, "Don't say that so loud." And I said, "Well, you asked me, was I a communist? And you're saying I am." And I said, "I'm agree." He said, "Shh. Hush," he said, "don't say that so loud." He says, "I think you ought to get out of here and go back to work." And I said, "Well, you called me. Why did you call me?" He said, "Well, never mind what I called you for. Go back to work." I had been always one of these individuals who felt that I could handle my own problems my own way, and do things myself. I didn't ever ask anybody to do anything to help me out in any way. Well, what was the results of going with all those people going behind me taught me one thing, that when a bunch of people come with you, that could make a colonel say, hush, get out of here, go back to work. When we finished one of these beautiful ships, and I remember them, two of them went down the way without me. One of them I rode down with it. It was an inspiring, thrilling thing. Here is something you have done, you've worked on, and once it went down into the water and withstood the test of staying afloat, I don't know how to describe it. It's a thrill. Your whole body is thrilled from it because you've done something that's worthwhile.
One night, close to Christmas, we were really cold in spite of working with the torches because the wind was blowing through the broken windows. We put stuffed rags into the holes, but it was no good. My co-worker, who was a black man from the South, and I were doing our usual trip around the farm case, welding the sides. And this particular night, I think I was feeling a little low altogether. The war was taking a long, long time, and the men were away, not for a year or two, but for the duration, which might mean forever. And it was beginning to wear on me. And my partner, as he passed by, he raised up his goggles, and he really smiled into my face, and he said to me in Yiddish, Arbeit macht das Leben süß. And I looked at him, and it was the sweetest thing he could have said to me at that moment. Work makes life sweet.
Edith Stoner's husband is in Alaska. She took this job for the duration.
How do you like your job, Mrs. Stoner?
I love it.
How about after the war? Are you going to keep on working?
I should say not. When my husband comes back, I'm going to be busy at home.
Good for you.
Lee Dunning, who now welds on landing barges. Lee, what did you used to do?
Believe it or not, I was a baby nurse.
Well, quite a change to this.
Yeah, but the hours are much shorter.
What about after this war, Lee?
Well, this job belongs to some soldier. And when he comes back, he can have it.
Oh, that's swell.
Confident owner President Bill Jack spurs on the troops he commands.
The coming of peace will work no unemployment hardships on you. You women have been employed because the armed forces have called your husbands. Brothers or sons, each returning serviceman will get his job back when this war is won. And you women and girls will go home, back to being housewives and mothers again, as you promised to do when you came to work for us. If all industry would adopt simple policy, there would be no serious post-war problem of unemployment.
Marches on.
Something you really cannot imagine. I remember my mother-in-law running down the street, and she was saying to the grocer, "You're not going to get those prices from us anymore," because during the war, prices rose unconscionably. They tried to hold a lid on them, but often she said, "No more 2 for $5, it's going to be 4 for $5. But she was wrong. Anyway, the day was marvelous.
We were glad the war was over, we really were, because even though you didn't have anybody over there, you're working with everybody else that had somebody over there. And they're so glad because, you know, their husbands and brothers are coming home. And so naturally you just get in the spirit of it with them. You know, everybody's celebrating.
My husband was home. He had been sent home a week before. And it was simply marvelous for a lot of people, and not so marvelous for others who had lost loved ones. But the feeling of the day was happy. And of course, at that point, we felt that even the losses had been for a very, very good cause. We had to look at it that way.
Now he returns. What does he want? With the sight of home still beyond the horizon, he's undeniably thinking of a number of things. The longest sleep in the softest feather bed the world has ever known. A platoon of bathing beauties who only have eyes for him. But when the idle dream has drifted, most of all, the average soldier wants simply a job. He returns, armed for a civilian future, with training and skills adapted to an amazing variety of civilian jobs. This man, and 1,000-odd others of him, now return. He represents, once again, the best of America. The most capable potential group of workers the nation has ever known.
The women were laid off first, and then the less senior black men were laid off next, and then last but not as the time went on, finally many of the white workers were laid off. But originally, the first ones laid off was women.
Apparently, the contract for the bomb cases had been fulfilled, and we were given notice, and the job was over.
I knew that the job would terminate when the war was over, and that's why I went, I'd work my shift, go on down to the welding school, and I took it all. You see, just to be a welder, you don't have to take it all, but I took it all, the acetylene and, oh, there's about 3 or 4 different kinds of welding. And I went to school after work for 4 hours so that when I got out there, I could get a job of welding because I really enjoyed it and I really liked it.
I knew how to rivet, I knew how to weld, I knew how to work on an assembly line, I knew how to run a dolly, you know, to get parts out. I thought I had several skills that were, you know, very good, and I wouldn't have any problems getting a job anywhere else.
We believed that the economy was going to burgeon. It would be splendid. We would rebuild the cities. We would do all these things because before the war, we didn't have all these skilled people. But now we had, the war would be over. It would be time to do all the good and beautiful things for America because fascism was destroyed.
All over the country in the past few months, businessmen have been buckling down to the work of research and planning how the changeover to production for peace can be accomplished without even a temporary breakdown. At the same time, government agencies are faced with the task of having to find jobs for returning veterans who are now being discharged from the services at the rate of $70,000 a month.
How do you do, Mr. Watson?
How do you do, sir?
I have all your papers here. You take this slip over to Bishop's. They need a man in the tool checking room there. I know you're qualified, and you're first.
Well, thanks a lot.
Informed industrialists believe that with the coming of peace, there will be a market for all they can produce. not only in the United States, but abroad. And perhaps more important, those undeveloped regions of Asia and Africa, to whose people war has brought new glimpses of modern industrial civilization. From these lands can come raw materials American industries already consume in vast quantities. All surveys have revealed an immense demand among the American people for consumers' goods.
The first thing I'm going to do after the war is get a vacuum cleaner and a maid to run it.
Millions of Americans, the surveys show, are waiting for a chance to buy the new products and new gadgets that they have been told will make life easier and pleasanter. Today, industrialists are resolved that all employable men and women, all homecoming veterans, shall find the post-war jobs that will secure for them their self-respect, their living, and their nation's future.
They wanted to put the women in sewing because in specifying that they had to use these sewing power machines, they knew a lot of women didn't know how to use them. And they just give you your material and say, this is what I want you to do. And they come back in a few minutes and this is all you got done. Maybe you finally manage to see what goes where and maybe do it a little bit. Then they'll right away, they'll disqualify you because, well, you'll have to wait until we get something you can do because you can't do this.
There was an ad in the paper, and I heard, too, that they were needing welders at Mare Island. So I took my card and all my credentials and everything, and I went out there, and I laid my papers on the desk, and he looked at them, and he said, it's all right. He said, if you was a man, we'd hire you, but we can't hire you. You're a woman.
The biggest thing I felt was the fact that now I had just to go back to the field of searching for another job to make a living with no income, no nothing coming in, and you're walking the street going from place to place looking for a job.
It wasn't like a dance in an opera. The men came home beat up. The men came home with problems. They gave them free ads in the newspapers looking for jobs. It was pathetic. And we were no longer comrades in arms. We were competitors for what little there was. It was a very sharp contrast indeed, because there was a lot of money around, but it wasn't in our pockets.
I sort of went to a few places, walked around, looked up names, went to the state employment agency, but there were no welding jobs. And then I started to walk around my own neighborhood in Brooklyn, and I went into one place where they used to do ornamental ironwork, and I guess they had war contracts. And I thought, well, maybe this was a neighborhood business that was going to continue. But they really just laughed at me. It was the same old thing. There was just, you know, being a woman, it was over for us. Yes.
The family was solidly founded on the father as patriarch and breadwinner, and on the mother as cook, housekeeper, and nurse of the children. One of the trends of modern life, which has been cited as most disruptive of marriage, is the increasing economic independence of women. Today, U.S. industry is employing hundreds of women who, before the war, were homemakers, devoting their full time to their families and their family responsibilities. Everywhere, children of working parents are being left without adequate supervision or restraint. Today, the woman with a position in business equal to a successful man's is economically able to terminate her marriage if she is so minded, since she is her own breadwinner. But are such women really better off? Strongly against careers for women is Dr. Maronia Farnham, noted physician and co-author of the bestseller, Modern Woman, The Lost Sex.
Catastrophic social forces have propelled American women away from femininity and into careers at terrific cost to themselves and society. Abandoning their feminine role has made women unhappy because it has made them frustrated. It has made children unhappy because they do not have maternal love. And it has made their husbands unhappy because they do not have real women as partners. Instead, their wives have become their rivals.
They had sold us a bill of goods, they have trained us, we did what we had really been set out to do, and everything else was something that we had wished to do. There were no plans.
wherever these plans are made to keep us. And this was very clear to me by then. So I just took my next step because I was a working person, not only a welder, I was a working person, someone who had to keep working.
You have a lot of responsibility, especially a widow woman, a lone woman. My children had to be taken care of, and I'd bought a little home. It had to be paid for. I had to get a job somewhere, somehow. I knew that. And that's what I was thinking about when I left there. I got a job in a restaurant working in the kitchen. Hot, hard work, heavy lifting. It was a lot harder than working in the shipyard, and a lot less pay. I worked there 17 years in that big kitchen, 17 years to the day.
I had a daughter I had to feed. So after I couldn't get these other jobs, well, then I had to fall back on the only other thing I knew, and that was doing domestic work. And it was a very defeating thing for me, very.
I got a job in Cosgrave's department store working as a stock girl. Well, they had black people working in the stores, but they all worked behind the scenes, in the toilets as maids, in the stock rooms as hanging up stock and keeping the stock in order, pressing and things like that. No, they didn't even have pressers.
So I went to the airport and got a job out there, in the right back in the cafeteria. I could always get these jobs, but even though I didn't want them, but anytime there's a restaurant job or a dishwashing job or cooking job, I always felt like blacks could always get those because they save those jobs for us.
I did mimeographing, and then they took in a new machine called dexographing, and that was sort of interesting. They taught me darkroom work. I liked welding better because it was a special thing. As I said, I always, at the end of the day, I always felt I accomplished something. It was good. There was a product. There was something to be seen. It could have been this. It would have been the same way. Would have been better if it had not been for the war. All I really wanted was one day to make a very beautiful ornamental gate. That was something I wanted to do. I still think about it when I pass a beautiful gate. I say, was that so much to want?
In the past year, an estimated 1.25 million new families and households were established. To these and other families, almost 4 million babies were born last year, representing a rise of more than 50% in the U.S. birth rate over that of pre-war years. For marriage and the founding of a family hold out today, as they always have, a greater promise of self-realization than any other course in life.
Oh, yes, yes, everybody was having babies. After the war, my God, it was like a deluge of babies. When I went to have my first baby, there wasn't even room. People were having, they were doing labor in the halls. I mean, it was really, it was unbelievable. Oh, yes, everybody, everybody. And her sister was having a baby.
The articles in the magazines changed. They started telling you how to cook things that took a long time. You know, during the war, they was telling you how to cook dishes that you could cook quick and get on to work. Now they were telling you how to cook dishes that took a full day. There were more articles in there about raising your children and the psychological development of your children. They never mentioned that, you know, any psychological development before the war. The movies changed to romantic, kind of macho wars. The man was back home, and the women was submissive, and the man was macho. Before, both of them was macho. The nurse was dying with the soldier in the field. Now it was a whole different tact and a whole different kind of propaganda to let women know what they should be doing.
I know that lots of the women who went to training with me and who worked with me believed that we were the new woman. We believed it. I think to America at large, while they may have known what our contribution was to the production of this country, we were largely a joke. A big joke, a shapely girl with a hot sign on her pants, a girl who was quivering for her man to come home and go back to the kitchen. That's exactly the picture that was given. And I think that they prepare women psychologically for whatever role the society feels at that particular point they want her to play. After losing so many men, America wanted babies. And we wanted babies. It's okay. But we gave up everything for that. We gave up everything. Really a really smart looking group of ladies, and we all loved one another, and I hope for that feeling in this country again, but not for a war.
Jittery. Rosie!